Namaste. Myself Ankita Shreya Prasad, and you are listening to along with our NCERT 11th and 12th audio video book presented by Artskill Passion. Chapter 1: Electric Charges and Fields. 1.1: Introduction. All of us have the experience of seeing a spark or hearing a crackle when we take off our synthetic clothes or sweaters, particularly in dry weather. This is almost inevitable with ladies' garments like a polyester sarees. Have you ever tried to find any explanation for this phenomenon? Another common example for electric discharge is the lightning that we see in the sky during thunderstorms. We also experience a sensation of an electric shock either by opening the door of a car or holding the iron bar of a bus after sliding from our seat. The reason for this experience is discharge of electric charges through our body, which were accumulated due to rubbing of insulating surfaces. You might have also heard that this is due to generation of static electricity. This is precisely the topic we are going to discuss in this and the next chapter. Static means anything that does not move or change with time. Electrostatics deals with the study of forces, fields, and potential arising from static charges. 1.2. Electric charge. Historically, the credit of discovery of the fact that amber rubbed with wool or silk cloth attracts light objects goes to Thales of Miletus, Greece, around 600 BC. The name electricity is coined from the Greek word electron, meaning amber. Many such pieces of materials were known which on rubbing could attract light objects like straw, pith ball, and bits of paper. You can perform the following activity at home to experience such an effect. Cut out long thin strips of white paper and lightly iron them. Take them near a TV screen or computer monitor. You will see that the strips get attracted to the screen. In fact, they remain stuck to the screen for a while. It was observed that if two glass rods rubbed with wool or silk cloth are brought close to each other, they ripple each other. Figure 1.1a. The two strands of wool or two pieces of silk cloth with which the rod were rubbed also ripple each other. However, the glass rod and wool attract each other. Similarly, two plastic rods rubbed with cat's fur repelled each other, figure 1.1b, but attracted the fur. On the other hand, the plastic rod attracts the glass rod, figure 1.1c, and repels the silk or wool with which the glass rod is rubbed. The glass rod repels the fur. If a plastic rod rubbed with fur is made to touch two small pith balls, nowadays we can use polystyrene balls suspended by silk or nylon thread. Then the balls ripple each other, figure 1.1d, and are also repelled by the rod. A similar effect is found if the pith ball are touched with a glass rod rubbed with silk, figure 1.1e. A dramatic observation is that pith ball touched with glass rod attracts another pith ball touched with plastic rod. Figure 1.1f. Figure 1.1. Rods and pith balls. Like charges ripple and unlike charges attract each other. These seemingly simple facts were established from years of effort and careful experiments and their analysis. It was concluded after many careful studies by different scientists that there were only two kinds of an entity which is called the electric charge. We see that the bodies like glass or plastic rods, silk, fur and pith ball are electrified. They acquire an electric charge on rubbing. The experiments on pith balls suggested that there are two kinds of electrification, and we find that first, like charges ripple, and second, unlike charges attract each other. The experiments also demonstrated that the charges are transferred from the rod to the pith balls on contact. It is said that the pith balls are electrified or are charged by contact. The property which differentiates the two kinds of charges is called the polarity of charge. When a glass rod is rubbed with silk, the rod acquires one kind of charge and the silk acquires the second kind of charge. This is true for any pair of objects that are rubbed to be electrified. Now, if the electrified glass rod is brought in contact with silk with which it was rubbed, they no longer attract each other. They also do not attract or repel other light object as they did on being electrified. Thus, the charges acquired after rubbing are lost when the charged bodies are brought in contact. What can you conclude from this observation? It just tells us that unlike charges acquired by the objects, neutralize or nullifies each other effect. Therefore, the charge were named as positive and negative by the American scientist Benjamin Franklin. We know that when we add a positive number to a negative number of the same magnitude, the sum is zero. This might have been philosophy in naming the charges as positive and negative. By convention, the charge on glass rod or cat's fur is called positive and that on plastic rod or silk is termed negative. If an object possesses an electric charge, it is said to be electrified or charged. When it has no charge, it is said to be electrically neutral. A simple apparatus to detect charge on a body is the gold leaf electroscope. Figure 1.2a. It consists of a vertical metal rod housed in a box with two thin gold leaves attached to its bottom end. When a charged object touches the metal knob at the top of the rod, charge flow on the leaves and they diverge. The degree of divergence is an indicator of the amount of charge. Students can make a simple electroscope as follows. Figure 1.2b. Take a thin aluminium curtain rod with ball ends fitted for hanging the curtain. Cut out a piece of length about 20 cm with the ball at one end and flatten the cut end. Take a large bottle that can hold this rod and a cork which will fit in the opening of bottle. Make a hole in the cork sufficient to hold the curtain rod snugly. Slide the rod through the hole in the cork with the cut end on the lower side and ball end projecting above the cork. Fold a small thin aluminium foil about 6 cm in length in the middle and attach it to the flattened end of the rod by cellulose tape. This forms the leaves of electroscope. Fit the cork in the bottle with about 5 cm of the ball end projecting above the cork. A paper scale may be put inside the bottle in advance to measure the separation of leaves. The separation is through measure of the amount of charge on the electroscope. To understand how the electroscope works, use the white paper strips we use for seeing the attracting of charged bodies. Fold the strips into half so that you make a mark of fold. Open the strip and iron it lightly with the mounting fold up, as shown in figure 1.3. Hold the strip by pinching it at the fold. You would notice that the two halves move apart. This shows that the strips has acquired charge on ironing. When you fold it into half, both the halves have the same charge, hence they repel each other. The same effect is seen in the leaf electroscope. On charging the curtain rod by touching the ball end with an electrified body, charge is transferred to the curtain rod and the attached aluminium foil. Both the halves of the foil get similar charge and therefore repel each other. The divergence in the leaves depend on the amount of charge on them. Let us first try to understand why material bodies acquire charge. You know that all matter is made up of atoms and or molecules. Although normally the materials are electrically neutral, they do contain charges, but these charges are exactly balanced. Forces that hold the molecules together, forces that hold atom together in a solid. The adhesive force of glue, forces associated with surface tension are basically electrical in nature, arising from the forces between charged particles. Thus, the electric forces is a pervasive and it encompasses almost each and every field associated with our life. It is therefore essential that we learn more about such a force. To electrify a neutral body, we need to add or remove one kind of charge. When we say that a body is charged, we always refer to this excess charge or defect of charge. In solids, some of the electrons, being less tightly bound in the atom, are charges which are transferred from one body to the another. A body can thus be charged positively by losing some of its electrons. Similarly, a body can be charged negatively by gaining electrons. When we rub a glass rod with silk, some of the electrons from the rod are transferred to the silk cloth. Thus, the rod gets positively charged and the silk gets negatively charged. No new charge is created in the process of rubbing. Also, the numbers of electrons that are transferred is a very small fraction of the total number of electrons in the material body. Also, only the less lightly bound electrons in a material body can be transferred from it to another by rubbing. Therefore, when a body is rubbed with another, the bodies get charged, and that is why we have to stick to certain pairs of materials to notice charging on rubbing the bodies. 1.3 Conductors and insulators. A metal rod held in hand and rubbed with wool will not show any sign of being charged. However, if a metal rod with a wooden or plastic handle is rubbed without touching its metal part, it shows signs of charging. Suppose we connect one end of a copper pipe to a neutral pith ball and the other end to a negatively charged plastic rod. We will find that the pith ball acquires a negative charge. If a similar experiment is repeated with a nylon thread or a rubber band, no transfer of charge will take place from the plastic rod to the pith ball. Why does the transfer of charge not take place from the rod to the ball? Some substances readily allow passage of electricity through them. Others do not. Those which allow electricity to pass through them easily are called conductors. They have electric charges, electrons, that are comparatively free to move inside the material. Metals, humans, and animals' bodies are conductors. Most of the non-metals like glass, porcelain, plastic, nylon, wood offer high resistance to the passage of electricity through them. They are called insulators. Most substances fall into one of the two classes stated above. When some charge is transferred to a conductor, it readily gets distributed over the entire surface of the conductor. In contrast, if some charge is put on an insulator, it stays at the same place. You will learn why this happens in the next chapter. This property of the materials tells you why a nylon or plastic comb gets electrified on combing dyed hair or on rubbing, but a metal article like spoon does not. The charges on metal leak through our body to the ground, as both are conductors of electricity. When we bring a charged body in contact with the earth, all the excess charge on the body disappears by causing a momentary current to pass to the ground through the connecting conductors, such as our body. This process of sharing the charge with the earth is called grounding or earthing. Earthing provides a safety measure for electrical circuits and appliances. A thick metal plate is buried deep into the earth and a thick wires are drawn from this plate. These are used in buildings for the purpose of earthing near the mains supply. The electric wiring in our houses has three wires: live, neutral and earth. The first two carry electric current from the power station and the third is earthened by connecting it to the buried metal plate. Metallic bodies of the electric appliances such as electric iron, refrigerator, TV are connected to the earth wire. When any fault occurs or live wire touches the metallic body, the charge flows to the earth without damaging the appliances and without causing any injury to the humans. This would have otherwise been unavoidable since the human body is a conductor or electricity. 1.4. Charging by induction. When we touch a pith ball with an electrified plastic rod, some of the negative charges on the rod are transferred to the pith ball and it also gets charged. Thus, the pith ball is charged by contact. It is then repelled by the plastic rod but is attracted by the glass rod, which is oppositely charged. However, why a electrified rod attracts light objects is a question we have still left unanswered. Let us try to understand what could be happening by performing the following experiment. First, bring two metal spears, A and B, supported on insulating strands in contact as shown in figure 1.4a. Second, bring positively charged rod near one of the spears, saying A, taking care that it does not touch the spear. The free electrons in the spears are attracted towards the rod. This leaves an excess of positive charge on the raised surface of spear B. Both kinds of charge are bound in the metal spears and cannot escape. They therefore reside on the surface as shown in figure 1.4b. The left surface of spear A has an excess of negative charge and the right surface of B has an excess of positive charge. However, not all of the electrons in the spears have accumulated on the left surface of A. As the negative charge starts building up at the left surface of A, other electrons are repelled by these. In a short time, equilibrium is reached under the action of force of attraction of the rod and the force of repulsion due to the accumulated charges. Figure 1.4b shows the equilibrium situation. The process is called induction of charge and happens almost instantly. The accumulated charges remain on the surface as shown till the glass rod is held near the spear. If the rod is removed, the charges are not acted by any outside force and they redistribute to their original neutral state. Third, separate the spear by a small distance while the glass rod is still held near spear. A. As shown in figure 1.4c, the two spears are found to be oppositely charged and attract each other. Fourth, remove the rod. The charges on spears rearrange themselves as shown in figure 1.4d. Now separate the spears quite apart. The charges on them get uniformly distributed over them as shown in figure 1.4e. In the process, the metal spears will each be equal and oppositely charged. This is charging by induction. The positively charged glass rod does not lose any of its charge, contrary to the process of charging by contact. When electrified rods are brought near light objects, a similar effect takes place. The rod induces opposite charge on the near surface of the objects, and similar charges move to the further side of object. This happens even when the light object is not a conductor. The mechanism for how this happens is explained later in section 1.10 and 2.10. The centers of the two types of charges are slightly separated. We know that opposite charges attract while similar charges repel. However, the magnitude of forces depends on the distance between the charges, and in the case, the force of attraction overweighs the force of repulsion. As a result, the particles like bits of paper or pith ball being light are pulled towards the rod. 1.5 Basic properties of electric charge. We have seen that there are two types of charges, namely positive and negative, and their effects tend to cancel each other. Here, we shall now describe some other properties of electric charge. If the size of charged bodies are very small as compared to the distances between them, we treat them as point charges. All charge content of the body is assumed to be concentrated at one point in space. 5.1 Additivity of charges. We have not as yet given a quantitative definition of a charge. We shall follow it up in the next section. We shall tentatively assume that this can be done and proceeded. If a system contains two point charges Q1 and Q2, the total charge of the system is obtained simply by adding algebraically Q1, Q2, that is, charges add up like real number or they are scalars like the mass of a body. If a system contains n charges, Q1, Q2, Q3 and Qn, then the total charge of the system is Q1 plus Q2 plus Q3 and so on Qn. Charge has magnitude but no direction similar to mass. However, there is one difference between mass and charge. Mass of a body is always positive, whereas a charge can be either positive or negative. Proper signs have to be used while adding the charges in a system. For example, the total charge of a system containing 5 charges plus 1 plus 2 minus 3 plus 4 minus 5 in some arbitrary unit is plus 1 plus plus 2 plus minus 3 plus plus 4 plus minus 5 is equal to minus 1 in the same unit. 1.5.2 Charge is conserved. We have already hinted to the fact that when bodies are charged by rubbing, there is transfer of electrons from one body to another. No new charges are either created or destroyed. A picture of particles of electric charges enables us to understand the idea of conservation of charge. When we rub two bodies, what one body gains in charge, the body loses. Within an isolated system consisting of many charged bodies due to interaction among the bodies, charges may get redistributed, but it is found that the total charge of the isolated system is always conserved. Conservation of charge has been established experimentally. It is not possible to create or destroy net charge carried by any isolated system. Although the charge-carrying particles may be created or destroyed in a process. Sometimes nature creates charged particles. A neutron turns into a proton and an electron. The proton and electron thus created have equal and opposite charges, and the total charge is zero before and after the creation. 1.5.3 Quantization of charge. Experimentally, it is established that all free charges are integral multiples of a basic unit of charge denoted by E. Thus, charge Q on a body is always given by Q is equal to Ne. When N is an integer, positive or negative, this basic unit of charge is the charge that an electron or proton carries. By convention, the charge on an electron is taken to be negative. Therefore, charge on an electron is written as minus E and that on a proton as plus E. The fact that electric charge is always an integral multiple of E is termed as quantization of charge. There are a large number of situations in physics where certain physical quantities are quantized. The quantization of charge was the first suggested by the experimental law of electrolysis discovered by English experimentalist Faraday. It was experimentally demonstrated by Millikan in 1912. In the international system SI units, a unit of charge is called a coulomb and is denoted by the symbol C. A coulomb is defined in terms of the unit of electric current, which you are going to learn in a subsequent chapter. In terms of this definition, 1 coulomb is the charge flowing through a wire in 1S if the current is 1A ampere. See chapter 2 of class 11th physics textbook part 1. In this system, the value of basic unit of charge is E is equal to 1.602192 into 10 to the power minus 19 coulomb. Thus, there are about 6 into 10 to the power 18 electrons in a charge of 1 minus 1 coulomb. In electrostatics, charge of this large magnitude are seldom encountered and hence we use smaller units. 1 micro coulomb is equal to 10 power minus 6 or 1 micro coulomb milli coulomb is equal to 10 to the power minus 3 coulomb. If the protons and electrons are the only basic charges in the universe, all the observable charges have to be integral multiple of E. Thus, if a body contains N1 electrons and N2 protons, the total amount of charge on the body is N2 into E plus N1 into minus E is equal to N2 minus N1 into E. Since N1 and N2 are integers, the difference is also an integer. Thus, the charge on any body is always an integral multiple of E and can be increased or decreased also in steps of E. The step size is E is, however, very small because at the microscopic level, we deal with charges of a few microcoulomb. At this scale, the fact that charge of a body can increase or decrease in units or E is not visible. In this respect, the grainy nature of the charge is lost and it appears to be continuous. This situation can be compared with the geometrical concepts of points and lines. A dotted line viewed from a distance appears continuous to us but is not continuous in reality. As many points very close to each other normally give an expression of a continuous line, many charges taken together appear as a continuous charge distribution. At the macroscopic level, one deals with charges that are enormous compared to the magnitude of charge E. Since E is equal to 1.6 into 10 to the power minus 19 C, a charge of magnitude, say 1 microcoulomb, contains something like 10 to the power 13 times the electronic charge. At this scale, the fact that charge can increase or decrease only in units of E is not very different from saying that charge can take continuous values. Thus, at the macroscopic level, the quantization of charge has no practical consequence and can be ignored. However, at the microscopic level, where the charge involved are of the order of a few tens or hundreds of E, that is, they can be counted. They appear in discrete lumps and quantization of charge cannot be ignored. It is the magnitude of scale involved that is very important. 1.6. Coulomb's law. Coulomb's law is a quantitative statement about the force between the two point charges. When the linear size of charge bodies are much smaller than the distance separated them, the size may be ignored and the charge bodies are treated as point charges. Coulomb measured the forces between two point charges and found that it varied inversely as the square of the distance between the charges and was directly proportional to the product of the magnitude of the two charges and acted along the line joining the two charges. Thus, if two point charges Q1, Q2 are separated by a distance R in vacuum, the magnitude of the force F between them is given by F is equal to K Q1 Q2 divided by R square. How did Coulomb arrive at this law from his experiments? Coulomb used a torsion balance for measuring the force between two charged metallic. A torsion balance is a sensitive device to measure force. It was also used later by Cavendish to measure the very feeble gravitation force between two objects to verify Newton's law of gravitation. Spheres where the separation between two spheres is much larger than the radius of each sphere. The charged spheres may be regarded as a point charge. However, the charge on these spheres were unknown to begin with. How then could he discover a relation like EQ1.1? Coulomb thought of the following simple way. Suppose the charge on a metallic sphere is Q. If the sphere is put in contact with an identical uncharged sphere, the charge will spread over the two spheres by symmetry. The charge on each sphere will be Q by 2. Repeating this process, we can get charge Q divided by 2, Q divided 4, etc. Coulomb varied the distance for a fixed pair of charges and measured the force for different separation. He then varied the charges in pairs, keeping the distance fixed for each pair, comparing forces for different pairs of charges at different distances. Coulomb arrived at the relation equation 1.1. Coulomb's law, a simple mathematical statement, was initially experimentally arrived at in manner described above. While the original experiments established it at a macroscopic scale, it has also been established down to the subatomic level. Coulomb discovered its law without knowing the exact magnitude of the charge. In fact, it is the other way round. Coulomb's law can now be employed to furnish a definition for a unit of charge. In the relation equation 1.1, K is so far arbitrary. We can choose any positive value of K. The choice of K determines the size of the unit of charge. In SI units, the value of K is about 9 into 10 to the power 9 Newton meter square divided by Coulomb square. The unit of charge that results for this choice is called a Coulomb, which we defined earlier in section 1.1. Putting this equation of K in equation 1.1, we see that for Q1 is equal to Q2 is equal to 1, C is equal to R is equal to 1 meter, F is equal to 9 into 10 to the power 9 Newton. That is, 1 Coulomb is the charge that when placed at a distance of 1 meter from another charge of the same magnitude in the vacuum experiences an electrical force of repulsion of magnitude 9 into 10 to the power 9 Newton. 1 Coulomb is evidently too big a unit to be used. In practice, in electrostatics, one uses smaller units like 1 micro coulomb or 1 meter coulomb. The constant K in equation 1.1 is usually put as K is equal to 1 divided by 4 pi epsilon naught for later convenience, so that Coulomb's law is written as F is equal to 1 divided by 4 pi epsilon naught Q1 Q2 divided by R squared. Epsilon naught is called permittivity of free space. The value of epsilon naught in SI units is epsilon naught is equal to 8.854 into 10 to the power minus 12 C square N to the power minus 1 M to the power minus 2. Implicit in this is the assumption of additivity of charges and conservation. Two charges Q divided by 2 each add up to make a total charge Q. Since force is a vector, it is better to write Coulomb's law in the vector notation. let the position vectors of charges q1 and q2 be r1 and r2 respectively. See figure 1.6a. We denote force on q1 due to q2 by f12 and force on q2 due to q1 by f21. The two point charges q1 and q2 have been numbered 1 and 2 for convenience, and the vector leading from 1 to 2 is denoted by R21. R21 is equal to R2 minus R1. In the same way, the vector leading from 2 to 1 is denoted by R12. R12 is equal to R1 minus R2 is equal to minus R21. The magnitude of the vectors R21 and R12 is denoted by R21 and R12 respectively. R12 is equal to R21. The direction of a vector is specified by a unit vector along the vector. To denote the direction from 1 to 2 or from 2 to 1, we define the unit vectors. R21 is equal to R21 divided by R21. R12 is equal to R12 divided by R12. R21 minus R12. Coulomb's force law between two point charges Q1 and Q2 located at R1 and R2 respectively is then expressed as F21 is equal to 1 divided by 4 pi epsilon naught Q1 Q2 divided by R square 21. R21. Some remarks on equation 1.3 are relevant. Equation 1.3 is valid for any sign of Q1 and Q2, whether positive or negative, if Q1 and Q2 are of the same sign, either both positive or both negative. F21 is along R21, which denotes repulsion, as it should be for like charges. If Q1 and Q2 are of opposite signs, F21 is along minus R21 is equal to R12, which denotes attraction as expected for unlike charges. Thus, we do not have to write separate equation for the cases of like and unlike charges. Equation 1.3 take care of both cases correctly. Figure 1.6b. The force F12 on charge Q1 due to charge Q2 is obtained from equation 1.3 by simply interchanging 1 and 2. That is, F12 is equal to 1 divided by 4 pi epsilon naught Q1 Q2 divided by R square 12. R12 is equal to minus F21. Thus, Coulomb's law agrees with the Newton's third law. Coulomb's law equation 1.3 gives the force between two charges Q1 and Q2 in vacuum. If the charges are placed in matter or the intervening space has matter, the situation gets complicated due to the presence of charge constituents of matter. We shall consider electrostatics in matter in the next chapter. 1.7. Forces between multiple charges. The mutual electric force between the two charges is given by Coulomb's law. How to calculate the force on a charge where there are not one but several charges around? Consider a system of n stationary charges Q1, Q2, Q3, Qn in vacuum. What is the force on Q1 due to Q2, Q3, so on and Qn? Coulomb's law is not enough to answer this question. Recall that forces of mechanical origin add according to the parallelogram law of addition. Is the same true for the force of electrostatic origin? Experimentally, it is verified that force on any charge due to a number of other charges is the vector sum of all the forces on the charge due to the other charges, taken one at a time. The individual forces are unaffected due to the presence of other charges. This is termed as the principle of superposition. To better understand the concept, consider a system of three charges Q1, Q2 and Q3 as shown in figure 1.8a. The force on one charge, say Q1, due to two other charges, Q2, Q3, can therefore be obtained by performing a vector addition of the forces due to each one of these charges. Thus, if the force on Q1 due to Q2 is denoted by F12, F12 is given by equation 1.3, even though other charges are present. Thus, F12 is equal to 1 divided by 4 pi epsilon naught Q1 Q2 divided by R12 R squared R cap 12. In the same way, the force on Q1 due to Q3 denoted by F13 is given by F13 is equal to 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught Q1 Q3 divided by R square 13 R cap 13, which again is the Coulomb force on Q1 due to Q3 even though R charges Q2 is present. Thus, the total force F1 on Q1 due to two charges Q2 and Q3 is given as F1 is equal to F12 plus F13 is equal to 1 by 4 epsilon naught Q1 Q2 divided by R square 12 R cap 12 plus 1 divided by 4 pi epsilon naught Q1 Q3 divided by R square 13 R cap 13. The above calculation of force can be generalized to a system of charges more than 3 as shown in figure 1.8b. The principle of superposition says that in a system of charges Q1, Q2, so on and Qn, the force on Q1 due to Q2 is the same as given by Coulomb's law. That is, it is unaffected by the presence of the other charges Q3, Q4, so on and Qn. The total force F1 on the charge Q1 due to all other charges is then given by the vector sum of the forces 1, 2, F13, so on, and F1n. That is, F1 is equal to F12 plus F13 plus so on plus F1n is equal to 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught into Q1 Q2 divided by R square 12 R cap 12 plus Q1 Q3 divided by R square 13 R cap 13 plus so on Q1 Qn divided by R square 1n. R cap 1n is equal to Q1 divided by 4 pi epsilon naught. That is, sigma n I is equal to 2 Qi divided by R square 1i R cap 1i. The vector sum is obtained as usual by the parallelogram law of addition of vectors. All electrostatic is basically a consequence of Coulomb's law and the superposition principle. 1.8 Electric field. Let us consider a point charge Q placed in vacuum at the origin O. If you place another point charge Q at a point P where OP is equal to R, then the charge Q will exert a force on Q as per Coulomb's law. We may ask the question, if charge Q is removed, then what is left in the surroundings? Is there nothing? If there is nothing at a point P, then how does a force act when we place the charge Q at P? In order to answer such questions, the early scientists introduced the concept of fields. According to this, we see that the charge Q produces an electric field everywhere in the surroundings. When another charge Q is brought at some point P, the field there acts on it and produces a force. The electric field produced by the charge Q at point R is given as E into R is equal to 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught Q divided by R square and R cap is equal to 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught Q divided by R square R cap, where R cap is equal to R divided by R is a unit vector from the origin to the point R. Thus, equation 1.6 specifies the values of the electric field for each value of the position vector. The word field signifies how some distributed quantity, which could be scalar or a vector, varies with position. The effect of the charge has been incorporated in the existence of the electric field. We obtain the force F exerted by a charge Q on the charge Q as F is equal to 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught Q into small q divided by R square R cap. Note that the charge Q also exerts an equal and opposite force on the charge Q. The electrostatic force between the charges Q and small q can be looked upon as an interaction between the charge Q and the electric field of Q and vice versa. If we denote the position of charge Q by the vector R, it experiences a force F equal to the charge Q multiplied by the electric field E at the location of Q. Thus, F into R is equal to Q E into R. Equation 1.8 defines the SI unit of electric field as Newton Coulomb. Some important remarks may be made here. 1. From equation 1.8, we can infer that if Q is unity, the electric field due to a charge Q is numerically equal to the force exerted by it. That the electric field due to a charge Q at a point in a space may be defined as the force that a unit positive charge would experience if placed at that point. The charge Q which is producing the electric field is called a source charge, and the charge Q which does the effects of a source charge is called a test charge. Note that the source charge Q must remain at its original location. However, if a charge Q is brought at any point around Q, Q itself is bound to experience an electrical force due to Q and will tend to move. A way out of this difficulty is to make Q negligible small. The force F is then negligible small, but the ratio F divided by Q is finite and defines the electric field. E is equal to limit P raised to Q is equal to 0 F divided by Q. A practical way to get around the problem of keeping Q undisturbed in the presence of Q is to hold Q to its location by unspecified forces. This may look strange, but actually this is what happens in practice. When we are considering the electric force on a test charge Q due to a charge planar sheet. Section 1.15. The charges on the sheet are held to their locations by the forces due to the unspecified charge constituents inside the sheet. Second, note that the electric field E due to Q through defined operationally in terms of some test charge Q is independent of Q. This is because F is proportional to Q. So the ratio F divided by Q does not depend on Q. The force F on the charge Q due to the charge Q depends on the particular location of charge Q, which may take any value in the space around the charge Q. Thus, the electric field E due to Q is also dependent on the space coordinate R. For different positions of the charge Q all over the space, we get different values of electric field E. The field exists at every point in three-dimensional space. Third, for a positive charge, the electric field will be directed radially outwards from the charge. On the other hand, if the source charge is negative, the electric field vector at each point points radially inwards. Fourth, since the magnitude of the force F on the charge Q due to the charge Q depends only on the distance R of the charge Q from the charge Q, the magnitude of the electric field E will also depend only on the distance R. Thus, at equal distances from the charge Q, the magnitude of its electric field E is same. The magnitude of electric field E due to a point charge is the same on a sphere with the point charge as its center. In other words, it has a spherical symmetry. 1.8.1. Electric field due to a system of charges. Consider a system of charges Q1, Q2, so on and Qn with position vector R1, R2 and so on Rn relative to some origin O. Like the electric field at a point in space due to a single charge, electric field at a point in space due to The system of charges is defined to be the force experienced by a unit test charge placed at that point without disturbing the original position of charges Q1, Q2, so on and Qn. We can use Coulomb's law and the superposition principle to determine this field at a point P denoted by position vector r. Electric field E1 at r due to Q1 at r1 is given by E1 is equal to 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught Q1 divided by r square 1p r cap 1p, where r cap 1p is a unit vector in the direction from Q1 to p, and r1p is the distance between Q1 and p. In the same manner, electric field E2 at r due to Q2 at r2 is E2 is equal to 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught Q2 divided by r square 2p r cap 2p, where r cap 2p is a unit vector in the direction from Q2 to p, and r2p is the distance between Q2 and p. Similar expressions hold good for fields E3, E4, so on and En due to the charges Q3, Q4, so on and Qn. By the superposition principle, the electric field E at r due to the system of charges is as shown in figure 1.12. Figure 1.12. Electric field at a point due to a system of charges is the vector sum of the electric field at the point due to individual charges. Er is equal to E1 into r plus E2 into r plus and so on En r is equal to 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught Q1 divided by r1p square r cap 1p plus 1 divided by 4 pi epsilon naught Q2 divided by r square 2p r cap 2p plus so on 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught Qn divided by r square np r cap np. Er is equal to 1 divided by 4 pi epsilon naught sigma n I is equal to 1 Qi divided by r square ip r cap ip. E is a vector quantity that varies from one point to another point in space and is determined from the position of the source charges. 1.8.2. Physical significance of electric field. You may wonder why the notation of electric field has been introduced here at all. After all, for any system of charges, the measurable quantity is the force on charge, which can be directly determined using Coulomb's law and the superposition principle. Equation 1.5. When then introduce this intermediate quantity called the electric field. For electrostatics, the concepts of electric field is convenient but not really necessary. Electric field is an elegant way of characterizing the electrical environment of a system of charges. Electric field at a point in the space around a system of charges tells you the force a unit positive test charge would experience if placed at the point without disturbing the system. Electric field is a characteristic of the system of charges and is independent of the test charge and that you place at a point to determine the field. The term field in physics generally refers to a quantity that is defined at every point in space and may vary from point to point. Electric field is a vector field since force is a vector quantity. The true physical significance of the concept of electric field, however, emerges only when we go beyond electrostatics and deals with time-dependent electromagnetic phenomena. Suppose we consider the force between two distant charges Q1, Q2 in accelerated motion. Now, the greatest speed with which a signal or information can go from one point to another is c. The speed of light Thus, the effect of any motion of Q1 on Q2 cannot arise instantaneously. There will be some time delay between the effect force on Q2 and the cause motion of Q1. It is previously here that the notion of electric field. Strictly, electromagnetic field is natural and very useful. The field picture is this. The accelerated motion of charge Q1 produces the electromagnetic waves, which then propagate with the speed c, reach Q2 and cause a force on Q2. The notation of field elegantly accounts for the time delay. Thus, even though electric and magnetic field can be detected only by their effects, forces on charges, they are regarded as physical entities, not merely mathematical constructs. They have an independent dynamics of their own. That is, they evolve according to law of their own. They can also transport energy. Thus, a source of time dependent electromagnetic field turned on for a short interval of time and then switched off leaves behind propagating electromagnetic fields, transporting energy. The concept of field was first introduced by Faraday and is now among the central concepts in physics. 1.9. Electric field lines. We have studied electric field in the last section. It is a vector quantity and can be represented as we represent vectors. Let us try to represent E due to a point charge pictorially. Let the point charge be placed at the origin. Draw vectors pointing along the direction of the electric field with their lengths proportional to the strength of the field at each point. Since the magnitude of electric field at a point decreases inversely as the square of the distance of that point from the charge, the vector gets shorter as one goes away from the origin, always pointing radially outwards. Figure 1.15 shows such a picture. In this figure, each arrow indicates the electric field, that is the force acting on a unit positive charge, placed at the tail of that arrow. Connect the arrows pointing in one direction and the resulting figure represents a field line. We thus get many field lines, all pointing outwards from the point charge. Have we lost the information about the strength or magnitude of the field now? Because it was contained in the length of the arrow. No, now the magnitude of the field is represented by the density of field lines. E is strong near the charge, so the density of field lines is more near the charge and the lines are closer. Away from the charge, the field gets weaker and the density of field lines is less, resulting in well-separated lines. Another person may draw more lines, but the number of lines is not important. In fact, an infinite number of lines can be drawn in any region. It is the relative density of lines in different regions which is important. We draw the figure on the plane of paper that is in 2 dimension, but we live in the 3 dimensions. So, if one wishes to estimate the density of field lines, one has to consider the number of lines per unit cross-sectional area perpendicular to the lines. Since the electric field decreases as the square of the distance from a point charge and the area enclosing the charge increases as the square of the distance, the number of field lines crossing the enclosing area remains constant. Whatever may be the distance of the area from the charge. We started by saying that the field lines carry information about the direction of electric field at different points in space. Having drawn a certain set of field lines, the relative density, that is closeness of the field lines at different points, indicates the relative strength of electric field at those points. The field lines crowd where the field is strong and are spaced apart where it is weak. Figure 1.16 shows a set of field lines. We can imagine two equal and small elements of area placed at point R and S normal to the field lines there. The number of field lines in our picture cutting the area elements is proportional to the magnitude of field at these points. The picture shows that the field at R is stronger than at S. To understand the dependence of the field lines on the area, or rather the solid angle subtended by an area element, let us try to relate the area with the solid angle. A generalization of angle to three-dimensional. Recall how a plane angle is defined in two dimensions. Let a small transverse line element delta L be placed at distance R from a point O. Then the angle subtended by delta L at O can be approximated as delta theta is equal to delta L by R. Likewise, in three dimensions, the solid angle subtended by a small perpendicular plane area delta S at a distance R can be written as delta omega is equal to delta S divided by R square. We know that in a given solid angle, the number of radial field lines is same. In figure 1.16, for two points P1 and P2 at distances R1 and R2 from the charge, the element of area subtending the solid angle delta omega is R1 squared delta omega at P1 and an element of area R2 squared delta omega at P squared respectively. The number of lines CN cutting the area element are the same. The number of field lines cutting unit area element is therefore N divided by R1 square delta omega. At P1 and N, R square delta omega at P2 respectively. Since N and delta omega are common, the strength of the field clearly has 1 divided by R square dependence. The picture of field lines was invented by Faraday to develop an intuitive, non-mathematical way of visualizing electric field around charge configurations. Faraday called them lines of force. This term is somewhat misleading, especially in case of magnetic fields. The more appropriate term is field lines, electric or magnetic, that we have adopted in this book. Electric field lines are thus a way of pictorially mapping the electric field around a configuration of charge. An electric field line is generally a curve drawn in such a way that the tangent to it at each point is in the direction of the net field at that point. An arrow on the curve is obviously necessary to specify the direction of electric field from the two possible direction indicated by tangent to the curve. A field line is a space curve, that is, a curve in three dimension. Figure 1.17 show the field lines around some simple charge configuration. As mentioned earlier, the field lines are in three dimensional space. Through the figure shows the only in a plane. The field line of a single positive charge are radially outward, while those of a single negative charge are radially inward. The field lines around a system of two positive charges, Q, Q, give a vivid pictorial description of their mutual repulsion, while those around the configuration of two equal and opposite charges, Q, -Q, a dipole show clearly the mutual attraction between the charges. The field lines follow some important general properties. First, field line starts from positive charges and end at negative charges. If there is a single charge, they may start or end at infinity. Second, in a charge-free region. Electric field lines can be taken to be continuous curve without any breaks. Third, two field lines can never cross each other. If they did, the field at the point of intersection will not have a unique direction, which is absurd. Electrostatic field lines do not form any closed loops. This follows from the conservative nature of electric field. Chapter 2. 1.10 Electric Flux. Consider flow of a liquid with velocity v through a small flat surface ds in a direction normal to the surface. The rate of flow of liquid is given by the volume crossing the area per unit time v ds and represents the flux of liquid flowing across the plane. If the normal to the surface is not parallel to the direction of flow of liquid, that is to v, but makes an angle theta with it, the projected area in a plane perpendicular to v is delta ds cos theta. Therefore, the flux going out of the surface ds is v dot n cap ds. For the case of electric field, we define an analogous quantity and call it electric flux. We should, however, note that there is no flow of a physically observable quantity, unlike the case of liquid flow. In the picture of electric field lines described above, we saw that the number of fields line crossing a unit area placed normal to the field at a point is measure of the strength of electric field at that point. This means that if we place a small planar element of area delta S normal to E at a point, the number of field lines crossing it is proportional to E delta S. Now suppose we take the area element by angle theta. Clearly, the number of field lines crossing the area element will be smaller. The projections of the area element normal to E is delta S cos theta. Thus, the number of field lines crossing delta S is proportional to E delta S cos theta. When theta is equal to 90 degrees, field lines will be parallel to delta S and will not cross it at all. The orientation of area element and not merely its magnitude is important in many contexts. For example, in a stream, the amount of water flowing through a ring will naturally depend on how you hold the ring. If you hold it normal to the flow, maximum water will flow through it than if you hold it with some other orientation. This shows that an area element should be treated as a vector. It has a magnitude and also a direction. How to specify the direction of a planar area? Clearly, the normal to the plane specifies the orientation of the plane. Thus, the direction of a planar area vector is along its normal. How to associate a vector to the area of a curved surface? Imagine dividing the surface into a large number of very small area elements. Each small area element may be treated as planar and a vector associated with it, as explained before. Notice one ambiguity here: the direction of an area element is along its normal, but a normal can point in two directions. Which direction do we choose as the direction of the vector associated with the area element? This problem is resolved by some convention appropriate to the given context. For the case of a closed surface, this convention is very simple. The vector associated with every area element of a closed surface is taken to be in the direction of the outward normal. This is the convention used in figure 1.19. Thus, the area element vector delta S at a point on a closed surface equals delta S n cap, where delta S is the magnitude of the area element and n cap is the unit vector in the direction of outward normal at that point. We now come to the definition of electric flux. Electric flux delta theta through an area element delta S is defined by डेल्टा नॉट ई इज इक्वल टू ई डॉट डेल्टा एस इज इक्वल टू ई डेल्टा एस कॉस थीटा विच हैज बीन बिफोर इज प्रोपोर्शनल टू द नंबर ऑफ फील्ड लाइन्स कटिंग द एरिया एलिमेंट. द एंगल थीटा हियर इज द एंगल बिटवीन ई एंड डेल्टा एस फॉर अ क्लोज सर्फेस विद द कन्वेंशन स्टेटेड ऑलरेडी. थीटा इज द एंगल बिटवीन E and the outward normal to the area element. Notice we could look at the expression E delta S cos theta in two ways. E delta S cos theta, that is E times the projection of area normal to E, or E delta S, that is component of E along the normal to the area element times the magnitude of the area element. The unit of electric flux is n c to the power minus 1 meter square. The basic definition of electric flux by the equation 1.1 can be used in the principle to calculate the total flux through any given surface. All we have to do is to divide the surface into smaller area elements, calculate the flux at each element and add them up. Thus, the total flux not through a surface S is equal to not is equal to sigma E dot delta S. The approximation sign is put because the electric field E is taken to be constant over the small area element. This is mathematically exact only when you take the limit delta S give rise to 0 and the sum in equation 1.12 is written as an integral. 1.11 Electric dipole. An electric dipole is a pair of equal and opposite point charge Q and minus Q separated by a distance 2a. The line connecting the two charges defines a direction in space. By convention, the direction from minus Q to Q is said to be the direction of the dipole. The midpoint of location of minus Q and Q is called the center of the dipole. The total charge of the electric dipole is obviously zero. This does not mean that the field of the electric dipole is zero. Since the charge Q and minus Q are separated by some distance, the electric fields due to them when added do not exactly cancel out. However, at distances much larger than the separation of two charges forming a dipole are greater than 2a, the fields due to Q and minus Q nearly cancel out. The electric field due to a dipole therefore falls off at large distance faster than like 1 divided by r square. The dependence or r of the field due to a single charge Q. These qualitative ideas are borne out by the explicit calculation as follows. 1.11.1 The field of an electric dipole. The electric field of a pair of charge minus Q and Q at any point in space can be found out from Coulomb's law and the superposition principle. The results are simple for the following two cases. First, when the point is the dipole axis. Second, when it is the equatorial plane of the dipole, that is on a plane perpendicular to the dipole axis through its center. The electric field at any general point P is obtained by adding the electric fields E minus Q due to the charge minus Q and E plus Q due to the charge Q by the parallelogram law of vectors. First, for points on the axis, let the point P be the distance r from the center of the dipole on the side of the charge Q, as shown in figure 1.2a. Then E minus Q is equal to minus Q divided by 4 pi epsilon naught R plus A whole square P, where P cap is the unit vector along the dipole axis from minus Q to Q. Also, E plus Q is equal to Q divided by 4 pi epsilon naught R minus A whole square P. The total field at the P is E is equal to E plus Q plus E minus Q is equal to Q epsilon naught 4 pi epsilon naught into 4 AR divided by R square minus A square whole to the power of square. For r greater than a is equal to 4qa divided by 4 pi epsilon naught or q p cap r greater than a. Second, for points on the equatorial plane, the magnitudes of the electric field due to the two charges plus q and minus q are given by e plus q is equal to q divided by 4 pi epsilon naught into 1 by r square plus a square. E minus q is equal to q by 4 pi epsilon naught into 1 divided by r square plus a square and are equal. The direction of E plus q and E minus q are shown in figure 1.20b. Clearly, the components normal to the dipole axis cancel away. The components along the dipole axis add up. The total electric field is opposite to p cap. We have E is equal to minus E plus q plus E minus q cos theta p cap is equal to minus 2qa divided by 4 pi epsilon naught r square plus a square whole to the power 3 by 2p. At largest distance r greater than a, this reduces to E is equal to minus 2qa divided by 4 pi epsilon naught r cube p cap r greater than a forms equation 1.15 and 1.18. It is clear that the dipole field at large distances does not involve q and separately it is depends on the product qa. It suggests the definition of dipole moment. The dipole moment vector p of an electric dipole is defined by p is equal to q into 2a p cap. That is, it is a vector whose magnitude is charge q times the separation 2a between the pair of charges q minus q, and the direction is along the line from minus q to q. In terms of p, the electric field of a dipole at a large distances takes simple forms. At p on the dipole axis, ec is equal to 2p divided by 4 pi epsilon naught r cube r greater than a. At a point on the equatorial plane, e is equal to minus p divided by 4 pi epsilon naught r cube. Notice the important point that the dipole field at a large distances falls off, not as 1 by r square but as 1 by r cube. Further, the magnitude and the direction of the dipole field depends not only on the distance r but also on the angle between the position vector r and the dipole moment p. We can think of the limit when the dipole size 2a approaches 0. The charge q approaches infinity in such a way that the product p is equal to q minus 2a is infinite. Such a dipole is referred to as a point dipole. For a point dipole, equation 1.20 and 1.21 are exact. True for any r. 1.11.2. Physical significance of dipole. In most molecules, the centers of positive charges and of negative charges lie at the same place. Therefore, the dipole moment is zero. CO2 and CH4 are of this type of molecules. However, they developed a dipole moment when an electric field is applied, but in some molecules, the centers of negative charges and of positive charge do not coincide. Therefore, they have a permanent electric dipole moment, even in the absence of an electric field. Such molecules are called polar molecules. Water molecules, H2O, is an example of this type. Various materials give rise to interesting properties and important applications in the presence or absence of electric field. 1.12. Dipole in a uniform external field. Consider a permanent dipole of dipole moment p in a uniform external field E as shown in figure 1.22 by permanent dipole. We mean that p exists irrespective of E. It has not been induced by E. There is a force qe on q and a force minus qe on q. The net force on the dipole is zero since E is uniform. However, the charges are separated, so the forces act at different points, resulting in a torque on the dipole. When the net force is zero, the torque couple is independent of origin. Its magnitude equals to the magnitude of each force multiplied by the arm of the couple perpendicular distance between the two antiparallel forces. Magnitude of torque is equal to QE into 2A sin theta is equal to 2QAE sin theta. Its direction is normal to the plane of the paper coming out of it. The magnitude of P into E also PE sin theta and its direction is normal to the paper coming out of it. Tau is equal to P into E. This torque will tend to align the dipole with the field E when P is aligned with E. The torque is zero. What happens if the field is not uniform? In that case, the net force will evidently be non-zero. In addition, there will be in general be a torque on the system as before. The general cases involved. So let us consider the simpler situation when P is parallel to E or antiparallel to E in either cases. The net torque is zero, but there is a net force on the dipole if E is not uniform. Figure 1.23 is a self-explanatory. It is easily seen that when P is parallel to E, the dipole has a net force in the direction of increasing field. When P is antiparallel to E, the net force on the dipole is in the direction of decreasing field. In general, the force depends on the orientation of P with respect to E. This brings us to a common observation in frictional electricity. A comb run through a dry hair attracts pieces of paper. The comb, as we know, acquires charge through friction, but the paper is not charged. What then explains the attractive force? Taking the clue from the preceding discussion, the charged comb polarizes the piece of paper, that is, induces a net dipole moment in the direction of field. Further, the electric field due to the comb is not uniform. This non-uniformity of the field makes a dipole to experience a net force on it. In this situation, it is easily seen that the paper should move in the direction of the comb. 1.13 Continuous charge distribution. We have so far dealt with the charge configuration involving discrete charges Q1, Q2, so on and Qn. One reason why we restrict to discrete charges is that the mathematical treatment is similar and does not involve calculus. For many purposes, however, it is impractical to work in terms of discrete charges and we need to work with continuous charge distribution. For example, on the surface of a charged conductor, it is impractical to specify a charge distribution in terms of the location of the macroscopic charged constituents. It is more feasible to consider an area element delta S, figure 1.24, on the surface of the conductor, which is very small on the macroscopic scale but big enough to include a very large number of electrons, and specify the charge delta Q on that element. We then define a surface charge density sigma as the area element by sigma is equal to delta Q divided by delta S. We can do this at different points on the conductor and thus arrive a continuous function sigma called the surface charge density. The surface charge density sigma so defined ignores the quantization of charge and the discontinuity in charge distribution at the macroscopic level. Sigma represents macroscopic surface charge density, which in a sense is smoothed out average of the macroscopic charge density over an area element delta S, which as said before is large macroscopically but small microscopically. The unit for sigma are coulomb meter square. Similar consideration apply for the line charge distribution and a volume charge distribution. The linear charge density lambda of a wire is defined by lambda is equal to delta Q by delta L, where delta L is a small line element of wire on the macroscopic scale that, however, includes a large number of macroscopic charge constituents, and delta Q is the charge contained in that line element. The units for lambda are coulomb meter. The volume charge density, sometimes simply called charge density, is defined in a similar manner. Rho is equal to delta Q divided by delta V, where delta Q is the charge included in the macroscopically small volume element delta V that includes a large number of macroscopic charge constituents. The units for rho are coulomb meter cube. The notation for continuous charge distribution is similar to that we adopt for continuous mass distribution in mechanics. When we refer the density of a liquid, we are referring to its macroscopic density. We regard it as a continuous fluid and ignore its discrete molecular constitution. The field due to a continuous charge distribution can be obtained in much the same way as for a system of discrete charges. Equation 1.10. Suppose a continuous charge distribution in a space has a charge density rho. Choose any convenient origin O and let the position vector of any point in the charge distribution be R. The charge density rho may be vary from point to point, that is, it is a function of R. Divide the charge distribution into small volume elements of size delta V. The charge in a volume element delta V is rho delta V. Now consider any general point P inside or outside the distribution with position vector R. Figure 1.24. Electric field due to the charge rho delta V is given by Coulomb's law. Delta E is equal to 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught rho delta V divided by R square R cap, where R dash is the distance between the charge element and P, and R dash cap is a unit vector in a direction from the charge element to P. By the superposition principle, the total electric field due to the charge distribution is obtained by summing over the electric field due to different volume elements. E is equal to 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught sigma all delta V rho delta V divided by R dash square R cap dash. Note that rho, R dash, R cap dash all can vary from point to point. In a strict mathematical method, we should let delta V is equal to 0. And the sum then becomes an integral, but we omit that discussion here. For simplicity, in short, using Coulomb's law and the superposition principle, electric field can be defined for any charge distribution. Discrete or continuous are part discrete and part continuous. 1.14. Gauss law. As simple application of the notation of electric flux, let us consider the total flux through a sphere of radius r, which encloses a point charge q at its center. Divide the sphere into small area elements as shown in figure 1.25. The flux through an area element delta S is delta naught E dot delta S is equal to Q divided by 4 pi epsilon naught R square R cap delta S, where we have used Coulomb's law for the electric field due to a single charge Q. The unit vector R cap is along the radius vector from the center to the area element. Now, since the normal to a sphere at very point is along the radius vector at that point, the area element delta S and R cap have the same direction. Therefore, delta naught is equal to Q divided by 4 pi epsilon naught R squared delta S. Since the magnitude of a unit vector is 1, the total flux through the sphere is obtained by adding up flux through all the different area elements. Pi is equal to sigma all delta S Q divided by 4 pi epsilon naught R squared delta S. Since each area element of the sphere is at the same distance R from the charge, pi is equal to Q divided by 4 pi epsilon naught R squared sigma all delta S delta S is equal to Q divided by 4 pi epsilon naught R squared into S. Now S, the total area of the sphere, equals to 4 pi R squared. Thus, pi is equal to Q divided by 4 pi epsilon naught R squared into 4 pi R squared is equal to Q divided by epsilon naught. Equation 1.3 is a simple illustration of a general result of electrostatics called Gauss law. We state Gauss law without proof. electric flux through a closed surface S is equal to Q divided by epsilon naught. Q is equal to total charge enclosed by S. The law implies that the total electric flux through a closed surface is zero. If no charge is enclosed by the surface, we can see that explicitly in the simple situation of figure 1.25. Here the electric field is uniform and we are considering a closed cylindrical surface with its axis parallel to the uniform field E. The total flux pi through the surface is pi is equal to pi 1 plus pi 2 plus pi 3, where pi 1 and pi 2 represent the flux through the surfaces 1 and 2 or circular cross section of the cylinder, and pi naught is the flux through the curved cylindrical part of the closed surface. Now the normal to the surface 3 at every point is perpendicular to E. So by definition of flux, epsilon naught 3 is equal to 0. Further, the outward normal to 2 is along E, while the outward normal to 1 is opposite to E. Therefore, pi 1 is equal to minus E S1, pi 2 is equal to plus E S2. S1 is equal to S2 is equal to S, where S is the area of circular cross section. Thus, the total flux is 0 as accepted by Gauss law. Thus, whenever you find that the net electric flux through a closed surface is 0, we conclude that the total charge contained in the closed surface is 0. The great significance of Gauss law equation 1.13 is that it is true in general, and not only for the simple cases we have considered above. Let us note some important points regarding this law. First, Gauss law is true for any closed surface, no matter what its shape or size. Second, the term Q on the right side of Gauss law equation 1.31 includes the sum of all charges enclosed by the surface. The charges may be located anywhere inside the surface. Third, in the situation when the surface is so chosen that there are some charges inside and some outside, the electric field whose flux appears on the left side of equation 1.31 is due to all the charges both inside and outside S. The term Q on the right side of Gauss law, however, represents only the total charge inside S. Fourth, the surface that we choose for the application of Gauss law is called the Gaussian surface. You may choose any Gaussian surface and apply Gauss law. However, take care not to let the Gaussian surface pass through any discrete charge. This is because electric field due to a system of discrete charges is not well defined at the location of any charge. As you go close to the charge, the field grows without any bound. However, the Gaussian surface can pass through a continuous charge distribution. Fifth, Gauss law is often useful towards a much easier calculation of the electrostatic field when the system has some symmetry. This is facilitated by the choice of a suitable Gaussian surface. Sixth, finally, Gauss law is based on the inverse squared dependence on distance contained in the Coulomb's law. Any violation of Gauss law will indicate departure from the inverse squared law. 1.15 Applications of Gauss law. The electric field due to the general charge distribution is as seen above, given by the equation 1.27. In practice, except for some special cases, the summation or integration involved in this equation cannot be carried out to give electric field at every point in space. For some symmetric charge configuration, however, it is possible to obtain the electric field in a simple way using the Gauss law. This is best understood by some examples. 1.15.1 Field due to an infinitely long straight uniformly charged wire. Consider an infinitely long thin straight wire with uniform linear charge density lambda. The wire is obviously an axis of symmetry. Suppose we take the radial vector from O to P and rotate it around the wire. The point P, P dash and P double dash so obtained are completely equivalent with respect to the charge wire. This implies that the electric field must have the same magnitude at these points. The direction of electric field at every point must be radial outwards if lambda greater than zero, inward if lambda lesser than zero. This is clear from figure 1.29. Consider a pair of line elements P1 and P2 of the wire as shown. The electric fields produced by the two elements of the pair when summed by a given result electric field which is radial. The components normal to the radial vector cancel. This is true for any such pair and hence the total field at any point P is radial. Finally, since the wire is infinite, electric field does not depend on the position of P along the length of the wire. In short, the electric field is everywhere radial in plane cutting the wire normally, and its magnitude depends only on the radial distance r. To calculate the field, imagine a cylindrical Gaussian surface as shown in figure 1.29b. Since the field is everywhere radial, flux through the two ends of the cylindrical Gaussian surface is zero. At the cylindrical part of the surface, E is normal to the surface at every point and its magnitude is constant. Since it depends only on R, the surface area of curved part is 2 pi RL, where L is the length of the cylinder. Flux through the Gaussian surface is equal to flux through the curved cylindrical part of the surface is equal to E into 2 pi RL. The surface includes the charges equals to lambda L. Gauss law then gives E into 2 pi RL is equal to lambda L divided by epsilon naught. That is, E is equal to lambda divided by 2 pi epsilon naught R. Vectorially, E at any point is given by E is equal to lambda divided by 2 pi epsilon naught r n cap, where n cap is the radial unit vector in the plane normal to the wire passing through the point. E is directed outwards if lambda is positive and inward if lambda is negative. Note that when we write a vector A as a scalar multiplied by a unit vector, that is as A is equal to A small a cap. The scalar A is an algebraic number. It can be negative or positive. The direction of A will be the same as that of the unit vector A cap if A greater than 0 and opposite to A cap if A cap smaller than 0. When we want to restrict to a non-negative values, we use the symbol A and call it the modulus of A. Thus, modulus of A greater than 0. Also note that through only the charge enclosed by the surface, lambda L was included above. The electric field E is due to the charge on the entire wire. Further, the assumption of that the wire is infinitely long is crucial. Without this assumption, we cannot take E to be normal to the curved part of the cylindrical Gaussian surface. However, EQ 1.32 is approximately true for electric field around the central portions of a long wire where the end effects may be ignored. 1.15.2 Field due to a uniformly charged infinite plane sheet. Let sigma be the uniform surface charge density of an infinite plane sheet. Figure 1.30. We take the x-axis normal to the given plane. By symmetry, the electric field will not depend on y and z coordinates, and its direction at every point must be parallel to the x direction. We can take the Gaussian surface to be a rectangular parallel pipe of cross-sectional area A as shown. A cylindrical surface will also do. As seen from the figure, only the two faces 1 and 2 will contribute to the flux. Electric field lines are parallel to the other faces and they therefore do not contribute to the total flux. The unit vector normal to surface 1 is in the minus x direction, while the unit vector normal to surface 2 is in the plus x direction. Therefore, flux E delta S through both the surfaces are equal and add up. Therefore, the net flux through the Gaussian surface is 2
EA. The charge enclosed by the closed surface is sigma A, therefore by gas law, where 2EA is equal to sigma A divided by epsilon naught, or E is equal to sigma divided by 2 epsilon naught. Vectorically, E is equal to sigma divided by 2 epsilon naught n cap, where n cap is a unit vector normal to a plane and going away from it. E is directed away from the plane if sigma is positive and towards the plane if the sigma is negative. Note that the above application of gas law has brought out an additional fact. E is independent of x also. For a finite large planar sheet, equation 1.33 is approximately true in the middle region of the planar sheet away from the ends. 1.15.3 Feel due to a uniformly charged thin spherical shell. Let sigma be the uniform surface charge density of a thin spherical shell of the radius r. Figure 1.31. The situation has obviously spherical symmetry. The field at any point P outside or inside can depend only on r. The radial distances from the center of the shell to the point and must be radial, that is, along the radius vector. First, field outside the shell. Consider a point P outside the shell with radius vector r. To calculate E at P, we take the Gaussian surface to be a sphere of radius r and with center O passing through P. All points on this sphere are equivalent relative to the given charge configuration. That is what we mean by spherical symmetry. The electric field at each point of Gaussian surface therefore has the same magnitude E and is along the radius vector at each point. Thus, E and delta S at every point are parallel and the flux through each element is E delta S summing over all delta S. The flux through the Gaussian surface is E into 4 pi r squared. The charge enclosed is sigma into 4 pi r squared by gas law. E into 4 pi r squared is equal to sigma divided by epsilon naught 4 pi r squared, or E is equal to sigma r squared divided by epsilon naught r squared is equal to Q divided by 4 pi epsilon naught r squared, where Q is equal to 4 pi r squared. Sigma is the total charge on the spherical shell vectorically. E is equal to Q divided by 4 pi epsilon naught r squared r cap. The electric field is directed outward if Q greater than 0 and inward if Q lesser than 0. This, however, is exactly the field produced by a charge Q placed at the center O. Thus, for points outside the shell, the field due to a uniformly charged shell is as if the entire charge of the shell is concentrated at its center. Second, field inside the shell. In figure 1.31b, the point P is inside the shell. The Gaussian surface is again a sphere through P centered at O. The flux through the Gaussian surface calculated as before is E into 4 pi r squared. However, in this case, the Gaussian surface encloses no charge. Gauss law then gives E into 4 pi r squared is equal to 0. E is equal to 0. R greater than R. That is, the field due to a uniformly charged thin shell is 0 at all points inside the shell. This important result is a direct consequence of Gauss law, which follows the Coulomb's law. The experimental verification of this result confirms the 1 divided by r squared dependence in Coulomb's law.
Thank you for being till the end. I hope this has helped you. If so, give thumbs up, like, share, comment, save, download and subscribe. You can support us by following in other platforms. That link is in the description. Well, thank you. See you later. Maybe never.